Sound is coming. Can you check once? Please check sound.
But I cannot see you here. It is not. You go outside. You talk.
Sound is there?
Yeah.
Is okay? Okay. Good day to everyone. For some of you, it will be morning. Some of you, it will be evening. And that is the beauty, that the times that we are facing right now, and then the shift that happened in the knowledge delivery. So to keep up with that, we also have shifted our model to deliver the courses under this International Training Center of Operational Oceanography, being hosted by INCOES Hyderabad under Ministry of Earth Sciences, to the digital mode. And under that, we are happy to convey that this course, we have received very good registrations. So very high number of turnout, it was there. And we are happy that it made it so difficult for us to choose which platform we will deliver it in. And finally, as you are here right now, we're delivering on that on the YouTube Live. So my colleague will actually give you the course logistics after that. Before that, I wanted to give just a little background. So as the course title suggests, that this is the course related to fisheries oceanography. Now, whether it is in the fisheries realm or oceanography, only a handful of the researchers or people working on that particular realm will be actually addressing the questions pertaining to the other one. That is, very few oceanographers in the fisheries and very few fisheries knowledge researchers in the oceanography. We wanted to narrow this gap. And what could be the better option to do that, starting with the very base of the pyramid? That is the students who are very keen to learn new things and who will actually shape up the future. So that is the background of conceiving this particular course. And myself and my team are one of those few people who are actually well-versed with both the realms and who are the joining link. So that we felt that we could be delivering very nice content, and we hope that we will be able to. So that is this course is all about. About the registrations, we got almost 1400 registrations, and we hope that in future also we will be getting similar response. And to address that, we have kept some logistics on how you can attend that, how you will be able to get your certificate, how you will be able to, you know, progress to the higher level of courses. And we try to deliver these courses as much as possible in the like a no-cost model that we are having right now. So with that, I will I'll invite my colleague to explain about the course logistics. Stay tuned.
Good morning to all. Welcome to INCOES Fishery Oceanography for Future Professionals. Dear participants, the link for the lectures will be stay same in the case of you wish to revisit lecture. You may search in YouTube for INCOES official account, where the videos will be available. During the lecture, the chat options will be available, and some of our team members will be monitor the chat. Since the number of attendees is big, please use the chat only for asking questions and not for hi or good morning etc. At the end of the course, we will provide you a link for the test, which will be open for the 2 days for getting the e-certificate. Submitting the test is compulsory. You may share the lectures links, including YouTube, live to your friends who have not registered. However, the course certificate will be provided to only the registered participants who complete the test. We are planning to more batches of for this course in upcoming years. So you may encourage your friends and colleagues to register for it who could not the same time. Similarly, we are planning to hire that is advanced level of this course to register for the those completing the basic course successfully in the prerequisite. So please participate the this course attentively, and we hope you enjoy the course that we deliver. Last but not the least, at the end of the course, we will provide you feedback form. We encourage you to provide feedback to improve ourselves future courses. Thank you.
So PPT.
You can explain it to me.
I'll explain. So then I'll. Okay. Very good morning. So I'm Dr. Saurabh Maiti. I'll be starting the course with the Indian Marine Fishery Advisory Services instead of Dr. Nagaraja Kumar. So very good morning actually, and this is the first class. Be relaxed, and also whatever your query you can put in the chat box, so that after the lecture actually I can go through the queries and provide you the reply. Actually I'll try to address your questions. So give me just a second, actually I'll go to the presentation. So Indian Marine Fishery Advisory Services, which is popularly known as Potential Fishing Zone Advisory Service, so with which basically INCOI started. INCOI, this is the program which was actually formulated under the guidance of ISRO, Indian Space Research Organizations. So when it was started, it was there is a institute called Space Application Center under ISRO. So they used to tried to they only actually formulated this potential fishing zone advisories and popularly given the term as PFZ. What actually we are doing in this PFZ advisory services, later on actually there are few advisory services in the marine fishery sector. Actually it was included in the forecast system, that's why actually it was later termed as Indian Marine Fishery Advisory Services. Just a second.
This is share. I'm sharing. Not tell them I'm sharing.
I'll request all to just bear with us. We are just sharing this presentation.
No, this record sharing.
No, here only share the presentation will be there. Click now. Mm-hmm.
Hello, am I audible to you all? Can you put in chat box? Any one of you can respond?
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah. So again, actually, the thing is that I understand that I was not audible. So I hope now actually I'm audible to you all. So what I was mentioning that this is at the presentations, what I'm presently going to give you is the Indian Marine Fishery Advisory Services. So I'm Dr. Saurabh Maiti, and I'll be actually giving you these details of this Indian Marine Fishery Services in this presentation. So what is the presentation structure? I'll brief you here. The background and the introductions, I'll provide approach for the fishery advisory services, then fishery forecasting using RS and technology, remote sensing technology. I'll brief you here also. This fishery forecasting, how present world actually doing this fishery forecasting, and what is the Indian perspective, the popularly Indian PFZ mission. So Indian Marine Fishery Advisory Services is a broadly it's a program under that the main advisory services what we are providing, it is popularly known as potential fishing zone services. So Indian Marine Fishery scenario, I'll try to give you a glimpse of the of it, and also the PFZ generations and disseminations on daily basis, what actually INCO is doing. So that also I'll provide at the end of this presentations. I'll provide you the fisherman voice, means that is the feedback from the fishermen's what we are getting on regular basis from the maritime states, where actually we, on regular basis presently we are providing this advisory services. So the background. So as we all know that sea as one of the main source of food for the human, and fishing is one of the man's oldest activities in the world, continues depend on the fishing. So fishermen always try to find out where the marine mammals and the fishes are available so that they can catch it actually. So fishermen search for the fishing souls with a lot of efforts actually. There is a huge every time this stock is dwindling, and where the major challenges actually I'll also come into this. This fishing communities have developed over a generations there actually the practice, indigenous methods are there. So presently actually they are continuing with their methodology. So what are the fishing heritage from the fishermen we are getting actually? So what are the indigenous knowledge basically they are using to catch? So when they are getting a bird congregations in a particular area based on the color, bubbles breaking on the surface, then muddy, oily water and calm sea, then reflection in the night, Kaladu is again a smell. So this type of actually features they are searching in the ocean. This is the common practice happening among the fishermen. And based on that common practice, actually, they are trying to search the fish shoal and for the for their present catch. So what are the challenges actually in this normal practices? It's a very old heritage going on for a long time, but what is the present problem? So that in this slide actually I'll try to mention that locating and catching fish is a challenging stock, as the stock all over world actually it's going down. It's a really a challenging job actually to find out. Many time fishermen spends a huge amount of fuel that and they are going for catching the fish, but unfortunately instead of so much cost actually they are actually losing the stock. Then increase atmospheric carbon dioxide, as they are using huge amount of fossil fuels, and actually that carbon dioxide that having a huge impact. and a reliable, timely forecast on the potential zones, which is sustainable in nature. So that is actually very important at this point of time, actually. So that's why actually these challenges I have pointed out in these slides. And what are the capacity actually of remote sensing, with which actually whether we can try to address this problem, and we can give a sustainable kind of forecast or advisories to the fishermen, so that a good amount of catch they can get without hampering the ecosystem. So RS, remote sensing for marine applications, started back in 1960s. So this was started basically with these astronauts who used to take the pictures from the Earth. Then marine applications of the satellite remote sensing have been developed, developed. Then use of new sensors actually improved spatial and radiometric resolutions, easier data access, ability to process and disseminate vast amount of data with the process of computational facilities, and increasing awareness of advantages of remote sensing among the people, so that they can adopt this kind of techniques to actually make their problem easier. So actually based on that remote sensing technology, actually we have developed this potential fishing zone advisories. Here are the some remote sensing satellites which are popularly used for starting actually for this purpose. So radiometers are there, so the visible infrared and also infrared. What are the I have mentioned some of the satellites. So here you can see popularly known as the Indian satellites are here: OceanSat 1, OceanSat 2, OceanSat 3 is coming in picture, Saral, Altica. So MODIS is from US, NASA, then NOAA VHRR. So it is from US again. The earlier satellites are also mentioned here, like CWIPS, so on. So radiometer, what are visible and infrared actually we are using and taking the parameters, that is sea surface temperature, radiometer in visible spectrum. Using that sensors, actually we are getting the data and the coastal processes informations. Then radio, with the help of radiometer in microwave, actually we are getting the wind speed, sea surface temperature, also sea ice informations. Then altimeter, actually here it is there, so wave height, sea level, sea ice, elevation, surface wind, through scatterometer, and there are again SAR. So SAR, with the help of SAR, wave spectrum and sediment informations we can get. So what are the approach actually, how these Indian Marine Fisheries Services actually going on? So I'll try to inform you here. So this is the fish schools cannot be seen directly from the satellite or altitude. It is not at all possible. Directly we can take the picture of the fish schools where it is moving. So what basically the variations in ocean conditions, and the variations with the help of variations in ocean conditions, basically we are trying to address this where this fish will be available. So variations in ocean conditions play key role in natural fluctuations of the fish stocks in their vulnerability. So our main target is that whether these type of ocean features actually we can identify with the help of this satellite, so that indirectly we can say that where the fish will be available. So what are the preferences of the fish? Many years research indicates that the fish have certain physical, metabolic and respiratory requirements, which necessitates their actual continued presence in certain areas or habitat for survival. They also migrate from one location to another location, so to find out a suitable environment where they can actually stay for a long time, and they can get a good amount of food also. So this scientific approach. So water temperature and its fluctuation is one of the most important environmental parameter. SST is an indicator of ocean process, like coastal upwelling, advections, mesoscale dynamic feature, like fronts, eddies, and etc. Sea surface temperature also the indicative parameter of the environment is most easily observed on the satellite image. So SST actually it's a good parameter which actually through satellite we can actually have an idea of the sea surface temperature, and that sea surface temperature is also directly linked with the fish. So to identify the ground, to identify the ground where actually fish will be available. Temperature is the oceanographic parameter that has been most successfully measured using remote sensing. So now the another approach here it is that as sea surface temperature is one of the major parameter, there is another approach, it's a chlorophyll. So chlorophyll, we all know it's if we want to actually target the phytoplankton biomass, so we have to get idea about the chlorophyll also, because this radiometer, the sensors actually cannot identify phytoplankton, but the through the ocean color technology actually we can identify through the chlorophyll. If in a phytoplankton locations a good amount of phytoplanktons are there and the chlorophyll concentrations also it will be high, so with the high chlorophyll content actually we can tell that this is a phytoplankton rich zone. So phytoplankton have a major role in the global carbon cycle also. Phytoplankton has a key role accurate assessment of the primary productions in open and coastal oceans. One of my colleague Dr. Satya will be giving you about the primary production details in the next I think in the tomorrow's class you will be getting idea about this. So informations on the availability of food is an important factor which control their occurrence, abundance, and migration in the sea. So chlorophyll A, which measure the phytoplankton, it's a proxy to the phytoplankton, is the indicator of the availability of food for fishes. So now in this diagram actually this is I'll try to explain you, it's a small animations actually, so you can directly get the idea about the what is the science behind this potential fishing zone advisory. So our target is where the fishery in the identify the zone where the fishery more fishes will be there. So and obviously we will try to identify the fishery zone, but which are vulnerable our target is that not to provide those information vulnerable in the sense of breeding ground, in the sense of near the coastal zones. Actually we deliberately actually omit, though we try, we through the satellite actually we can identify the spawning grounds, but deliberately we are avoiding. So if in a potential fishery zone is there, so primary producers will be there, so primary producer in the sense of phytoplankton will be more than primary produce consumer, so secondary consumer. So in a particular area if phytoplanktons are there, we assume that in particular food chain will be available here. So phytoplankton here in the right side of the panel you can see there are phytoplankton, zooplankton, so migrating midwater fishes. So this is a good animations through which actually anyone can understand how from the lower trophic level to the higher trophic level actually particular this species will be available. So phytoplankton with the help of satellite where it is in the surface, then followed by all other trophic level these classes will be available. So
Other things are there. Other lot of parameters are important. So dissolved oxygen is one of the most important parameters. Salinity is another most of the important parameter. But nutrient concentrations, then mixed layer depth information, subsurface thermal. But actually, I am mentioning here why, because there will be a lot of questions. Only sea surface temperature and chlorophyll you cannot predict. But it's an integrated service. Here I'll try to point out here that what in Indian Marine Fishery Advisory Service program in INCOIS we are continuing, it's an integrated service. So with the help of earlier, it started with the remote sensing with sea surface temperature and chlorophyll, but presently we are adding one by one all parameters. Those who are not from satellite technology, suppose this dissolved oxygen can't we get from the on real time, because it's a real time advisory. We have to provide on daily basis sea surface temperature. If I have to provide this information in the afternoon, then actually I need the particular imagery from today's imagery only. But we have no such technology that dissolved oxygen, salinity, nutrient concentration. Nutrients are very much important, because when we are talking about these phytoplanktons, actually, so phytoplanktons concentrations are directly linked with the nutrient concentrations. Then if we are going to the physics of this ocean, actually, if you can see this mixed layer depth and the subsurface thermal structure, these can't we get from the remote sensing. So this is the huge limitation. So now in INCOIS, why we are going through this, actually this inform what if remote sensing parameters we are getting through sea surface temperature, chlorophyll from the remote sensing, we have certain process. Those who are totally computational, because INCOIS is doing this modeling, and so with the help of modeling, actually we can get this dissolved oxygen, salinity, nutrient concentrations in informations like nitrate, phosphate, silicates, then mixed layer depths from the physical model, actually all are available. So subsurface thermal structures. So earlier we started with these remote sensing parameters. Now one by one from the modeling approach also we are incorporating. So here the light, what are the important parameters to identify the niche of this particular any fish we are talking about. So the light, chlorophyll, nutrients, wind, surface current, dissolved oxygen, satellite, and the temperature. Presently, the remote sensing certain parameters are temperature and chlorophyll, and wind also from the scatterometry actually we are taking. So here again, this is the present scenario of our advisory services. Here you can see OCM, MODIS. It's a popular ocean color actually. Satellite ocean color monitor presently two is in the picture, which is Indian satellite. MODIS is also there, and VIS is also there. So from these three set actually satellite, we are taking the ocean color remote sensing data. Again, there is a NOAA AVHRR. It's a satellite by US government. So it's a NOAA from NOAA. So we are getting the sea surface temperature informations. And with the sea surface temperature data, actually, we are identifying the upwelling zones. So as we told you that potential zones we are identifying from the chlorophyll, that is the where phytoplanktons are there. We are also checking with the sea surface temperature whether this upwelling can be identified, upwelling zones can be identified from the sea surface temperature. The boundaries also is very much, gradients are very much important. So if in a particular area, so this is the technique actually presently we are using. So if we, in one hand I have a sea surface temperature image, and in another hand I have a ocean color image. So all the images, the two images what we have, it is in the real-time image. Now with the help of sea surface temperature, actually we can identify the upwelling zones, because
the gradient, the fronts, sea surface temperature fronts, the thermal fronts. So we are identifying from the sea surface temperature. So if we are able to identify the upwelling zones, so those zones actually nutrient will be more. So all nutrients which are essentials for the phytoplankton to grow, for the photosynthesis, that actually with the help of this nutrient, actually if upwelling zones are there, then these nutrients will be more. So we are tracking on the regular basis whether any sea surface temperature, with the help of sea surface temperature, that upwelling zones can be identified or not. So if one identifies upwelling zones, so we are able to identify, we are tracking that upwelling zones, and if it is a upwelling zones are identified and potential upwelling zones are there, which may be sustained for some few days. So those are the important potential zones actually where your nutrients will be uplifted from the down. So if nutrients are uplifted, then with a lag, actually phytoplanktons will be there. And if phytoplanktons are there, which are the food of this fish, so this fish will automatically aggregate in this particular zone. So here you can see, this is the technique, this is some technical point that if we are going for the sea surface temperature, so what are the algorithms for the processing of this sea surface temperature? Like there is a multi-channel sea surface temperature algorithm, so it is actually used to pre-process data. So in INCOIS we are having the ground stations, we are our data teams are there. So from data teams, actually with the help of this MCSST algorithm, actually we are processing the pre-processing the images. And here in the chlorophyll also, we are using OC2. So these are the techniques, actually algorithms, again ocean color to OC2 actually algorithm, with the help of this bio-optical algorithm, actually we are processing to identify the chlorophyll. Now the fishery forecasting, what is the methods and the implementation status actually here. So here you can see, this is basically I have given you the brief idea about this remote sensing technique and how it is implemented in the marine fishery service management. So I'll now go in the details of this and actually where which in the world who are the major player actually who are using these techniques to manage this fish stock. So aerial photography and video images are from inception. I have mentioned you in the earlier slide also. So here you can see that radiometric lidar systems are also detections of the schools by return signals. So these are the some technical points. Actually, I just wanted to just mention a few of the point. So airborne radars are there, fish swimming or very close to the surface produce wavelets. Then SLAR picks up the small changes in the wavelets in the backscatter pattern, so caused by the fish schools. So these are the available techniques of which can be used for fish management, fishery management also in fishery advisories. The valuable is wind speed. Wind is another major parameter with which actually this potential fishing zone advisories are there. Why wind is much more important parameters? Because with the experience of our regular advisory services, we have seen that suppose we have identified a upwelling zones in a particular area, so but with the point of with the time, actually this particular zones will not be there for long time. There is a movement of entire mass will be moved towards direction. So that's why actually wind and surface currents are actually very much important to if presently today in a locations it will be there, but next within 2 days, 1 days or 2 days, in between, if there is a vigorous wind also, that mass is moving in the current directions. So that is what wind is very much important. So here are the some slides. I'll mention some actually countries who are major player in this remote sensing based advisory service for the fishery. So USA is having a very good program, and INCOIS is also actually associated with a lot of program with NOAA. So basically they are also using the similar technique. So SST boundaries, chlorophyll image, generate commercial fishery charts, strong colored fronts associated with favorable range of this species wise, those informations also they are providing. They generate the these SST charts 3 times a week for distribution to the fishermen via radio. So SST online service, US generates fishery charts for the SST images of NOAA also. So now fishery forecasting services, again some other points for the US. So they distribute through telephone, telecopiers, US mail and radio facsimile, then broadcast later directly to boats at sea also. Fishermen expressed the benefits in terms of reduction of search time as well as reduction of fuel time, fuel consumption. Estimated savings of cost will be $88,000 per year. So developed an expert system of for tactically fishing the charts, displays, satellite derived fishing probable areas, digital lat long depth, SST values, etc. for butterfish, resulted in a reduction in searching time by 70%. So Japan is also a very major player, and they have a very advanced technique to identify the zone in real time, and their fishermen are also very advanced fishermen. They are having the capability of analysis of that particular image. So if they are also location schemes use oceanic features like fronts, eddies, meanders, etc., observed through ocean color difference, then SST depths in ports and ground informations of fish catching data, fishing data. Their Kuroshio and Oishio current system serving the fishermen as a guide for fishing. They found that ocean color is more reliable factor for guiding tuna fishing efforts as compared to temperature. They consider blue color water as better for tuna fishing than creamy color. Japanese Fisheries Information Service Center, popularly known as JAFIC, provides satellite-based informations on fishing grounds disseminations. The fishermen use portable NOAA receiver processor to acquire knowledge on fishing sites, which minimize the delay in communications of the forecast information. Now Australia. So best fishing location seems to be within the eddies. Their output, report says CSIRO uses satellite-derived SST to plot probable locations of schools, jack mackerel, as jack mackerel is highly temperature dependent, about 15 degrees centigrade. They developed an automated system based on SST for tuna fishery exploration using remote sensing data. They use the remote video surveillance techniques to assess fish abundance. They use ocean color for an additional value to informations obtainable from SST. SST images are sent by telephone from receiving stations to the fishermen. Now China is also having a fishery forecasting system. They began the project with satellite remote sensing forecasting system of fisheries of South China Sea. They use SST chlorophyll current system and ocean upwelling information derived from satellites like FY and NOAA, etc. Analyze locations of possible fishing, grounds. Had proposal to develop a GIS-based forecasting system to predict fish distribution and migration. Dissemination proposals for delivering information to users via weather service program on CCTV. So Chile thermal, Chile is also having a similar kind of system. Thermal satellite images are used to identify the zones. Then France also supported the French albacore fishery. For that purpose, they use the NOAA VHR and METOSAT data. Then Portugal is also having, and Canada, former Soviet Union, they're also having their own system. So this is the research and observations actually presently what we are using for these identifications. Here in the two kinds of this picture I'll show in this. So basically the ocean fronts, meandering patterns, eddies, rings, mushroom feature shaped, then tongue shaped feature, coastal upwelling, self break fronts, plume fronts, then diverging fronts, converging fronts. All these fronts actually basically we are using through this NOAA AVHR thermal imagery. So now here you can see there are the gradients. These gradients are temperature gradient. These temperature gradients are very much important. Gradient means those who are not understanding which is basically the gradient or the fronts which are we are using for sea surface. I mentioned in my earlier slide that thermal fronts are important to identify the thermal gradient. So this is the gradient. Here you can see from the red to yellow. There is a strong gradient. So if in the color actually graph we are going, so there is a more than 1 degree differences are there. So here these type of gradients are very much important to identify the fronts. So these fronts basically we are using from the NOAA AVHR. Right side of the panel, you can see there are the plumes. So these plumes are also identified based on the chlorophyll. So here the plumes where the gradients are there in the thermal fronts, which are the zones are lesser in temperature, those area we have seen. If we overlay the sea surface temperature and the chlorophyll images, actually we can see that the chlorophylls are in the relatively in the fronts of which side is the relatively lesser in temperature, that side actually your chlorophyll concentrations are increasing. So if so that informations are very much important. So in a regular basis with the help of sea surface temperature and chlorophyll image, the priority job is that overlapping the data whether we can identify the upwelling zones, the thermal fronts. If the thermal fronts are identified, then on top of that, when we are actually putting this chlorophyll informations, whether really chlorophyll is increasing or not, that also need to be checked in a persisting features. So what are the persistence features? The persistent features are there. Suppose there is a locations where upwelling zones, upwelling started. So in the initial phase, the when the water is coming down from to the up, so your cold water with the nutrient is coming to the top. But immediately there we may not see that if nutrients are coming to the surface, immediately that chlorophyll or phytoplankton bloom cannot be seen. So the target is that we have to track that upwelling zones. Some upwelling zones are actually developing, but if there is a vigorous wind or some kind of processes are happening, so it will dissipate. So our goal is that persistence features need to be identified, which stays for longer time. So if persistence features are identified, where the good amount of gradient of temperatures we are getting, and we are following that, okay, upper nutrients are coming to the surface, let's check the chlorophyll on regular basis. If chlorophyll on regular basis we are checking in one point of time, we'll see there is a chlorophyll concentrations increasing in that particular area. So if your chlorophyll concentrations are increasing, so that increased chlorophyll concentrations is actually the proxy to the phytoplankton. So if you are if I'm going for a particular remote sensing images, when you zoom a particular remote sensing image, So it will be a square kind of pixels will be there. So on regular basis, we need to check that whether which particular pixels in the front area actually that chlorophyll is increasing. So that need to be checked for the in the around the persistence features. And once it is confirmed from the chlorophyll, then that can be identified as a potential ground for fishery. Then why matching features? Ocean color directly gives the informations of enhanced production attended by the fish stock. SST indicate suitable of the suitability of the environment for fishery resources and distribution. The combinations of SST and the chlorophyll matching feature, where it will actually tell whether where there is a enhanced production or not. That can be, as I mentioned, that can be cross verified. And the ocean color imagery can validate that. Yes, the sea surface temperature, what signal they are giving, that really it's a good signal. And after a lag, there is a potential actually growth of phytoplankton, ground where the phytoplankton is grown. So that is we are validating with the help of ocean color. That means the chlorophyll imagery. So now Indian PFZ mission, actually what basically in this particular, when it is transferred to the INCOS from that point of time onwards, this Indian PFZ mission here, I'll just wanted to mention you that it was developed back with the guidance of Indian Space Research Organization. So Indian Space Research Organizations, there is an institute called SAC, Space Application Center in Ahmedabad. So they have developed the technique. Then on regular basis, when government decided to go for a regular advisory service, which can actually increase the livelihood of the fishermen without hampering the potential these coastal zones, actually it's a to give a sustainable touch of that in that so that ecosystem can't be hampered. So that is why actually it was transferred to INCOS, and the INCOS started with a flagship program called the Indian PFZ mission. So Indian PFZ means that potential fishing zone mission. With the starting of this Indian potential fishing zone mission, from inception, actually we are continuing this service. Later a lot of other services also added, like ocean state forecast. When we are providing this PFZ information to the community to go for fishing in a zone where this fish will be available, so we when we are giving this information, we need to provide the sea safety informations. What will be the type of wave you will get in that particular area? What will be the current pattern? What will be the wind directions? So why INCOS is in picture, as I was in mentioning that, so with the help of SIM only remote sensing, it is not at all possible. So there is a focused research on the oceanography as well as this modeling need to be considered. So our sea safety informations, current informations, all are coming through the this modeling activity. So here I have already mentioned that livelihood information, safety informations, and the information's effectiveness. The we are providing this information, that is fine. Now sea safety informations, what we are providing, the understand that state of the ocean, winds, wave we are providing, know the movement of the cyclones jointly with IMD we are providing, plan the fishing or for operations, this navigation path, direction of casting nets, those informations we are providing in terms of surface current. So provide high wave alert, then tsunami early warning bulletins occasionally at the time of particular event. So information effectiveness. Now we are providing this information's livelihood and safety, whether this how much effective. So that right informations and timely through various ICT initiative, we are providing this informations, and to how effective it is, we are also getting the feedback from the community. Actually, here the present I've already mentioned sea surface temperature and chlorophyll. We are using satellite data products for the PFZ. So this PFZ, this is a potential fishing zone advisories. Here we are not providing any informations which kind of species will be available, but as this is a surface data, we are putting in the input like this all the sea surface temperature information. So we are targeting species will be pelagic species. So here you can see this I have already mentioned these two in the middle panel key indicators, where actually with the help of thermal we are identifying the thermal fronts as well as the plume from the chlorophyll. So that actually together we are taking, and this black line in the right panel on the top right the panel here, this is a typical advisory how it looks. So this is a advisories for I guess this is for the Andhra Pradesh, right? So this is for the Andhra Pradesh. Here you can see the bold lines, bold black color lines in the ocean. So here you can see the pinkish color ocean, this coastal line. After that ocean is there, that contours are, you can see these contours are basically bathymetric contours. And also this black bold color lines, curly lines, these lines are nothing but the potential fishing zone lines, actually the which is picked from the remote sensing images by cross validating. So suppose there is a good persistence in the thermal fronts, we are checking with the chlorophyll. Only those persistence features which are not falling in the zones, vulnerable zones, such as this is the breeding ground, spawning ground, where fish will be coming for the breeding. Those where if it is lines are there, those lines deliberately we are omitting and putting these lines where fish is coming for food. So those informations actually which is away from the coast, these informations only we are putting in the bold color black line. And in the down of this we are providing one table also. This table is in local languages. Suppose it is for the Andhra Pradesh, North Andhra Pradesh sector. So it is in three language it will be there. So English, Hindi, as well as Telugu. So in the first column, you can see there are landing center informations, which landing centers actually, if a particular fisherman is moving towards the ocean, which directions they have to use. The second columns are giving the directions. Suppose this is a 104. So 104 degree, that means I'm asking the fisherman to move towards east, southeast. Southeast direction 104, the bearing angle will be 104. How far they will be moving? The 104 to 109. This is through the GIS technique. Actually, we identified from the automatically from the GIS technique from the particular landing center. So 104 to 109 kilometer away, actually this line will be there. Now, if we are asking fishermen to go for that particular locations, we should have to provide the informations. What will be the particular what will the depth in that particular zones? Those information here you can see 2509 to 25114. So the approximate depth also informations we are providing. And the last two respective columns are for latitude and the longitude information. Suppose one fisherman, those who are not having GPS, with the help of these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 first six columns, actually with the help of compass only they can go in the particular location. However, if they are having GPS, directly they can feed the latitude longitude informations and directly move towards the zones where actually potential ground will be there. So I'll give a brief details from the starting. Actually, what are the changes happened? What are the major milestone in the Indian Marine Fishery Advisory Services? So it, as you can see, 2001. So based on the SST only, earlier only it was in the SST traditional methods. So films, zooming, overlaying, and hard copy based maps. The right side you can see the maps. Actually, these are the contours. Based on these, actually it was started in 2001 from the thermal fronts, actually with the by tracing, actually film, zooming, and overlapping methods. It's a entire manual process to identify the grounds. So later on in 2002 to 2003, there is a digital process came in picture with the help of remote sensing and GIS softwares. Actually, we started drawing these lines as well as giving the advisories. So 2006-07 became part of the Common Minimum Program of Government of India. 2006-07 onwards, actually this advisory during 2006-07 actually it came under Common Minimum Program of Government of India. Then 2007-08, so international recognitions it got. So it was recognized by Safari program and also Geo-Societal Benefit Areas program also. So then came in picture new generations. Now from the inception, actually this advisory used to go through the facts. So there are a lot of facts installed at that time in the coastal harbors, fishery office, then some of the association, fishermen associations office. So this kind of new generations EDVs, though it's there are old kind of EDVs also there, but this kind of new generations of EDVs came in picture in 2008 and 2009. Then what happened? Incorporations of wind feature shifts predictions. Now this is also with the help of SAC and INCOIS, actually joint research wind information was integrated. Why wind information was integrated? Suppose earlier now the advisory services are for daily advisory services. Earlier what we used to see that we used to give 3 weeks a day during 2009 to 2010, 3 weeks 3 weeks a day, a week, 3 days a week actually advisories used to give. Now if it is a valid for 48 hours or more than that, so today we are giving one advisory service, we don't know if which direction tomorrow it will migrate. So fishermen, if they are not using the advisory today, tomorrow which locations they will be going. Based on that, based on the wind informations, we used to predict the locations where tomorrow actually this what will be the probable ground where this feature will be migrated. So that informations we incorporated 2009 and 2010. Then 2010-11 experimental tuna fishery advisories came in picture, and use of GHRSST to overcome cloud cover. Why this GHRSST and what is this tuna fishery advisories? I'll little bit brief you here. So GHRSST, it's a group of high resolution sea surface temperature images. So this is a merged product from the in situ modeling as well as satellite informations. So what happened actually, what are the major limitations in the advisory while generating these advisories we face on a daily basis? If there is a cloud cover, actually there is a lack of data. A lot of patches are coming in particular sectors. There is no data from where actually sea surface temperature images are not there, chlorophyll images are not there, then how we will give? Now 2010 to 11 onwards, GHRSST, with the help of this data, actually that time it was the resolution was 225 kilometer. Now the higher graded upgraded resolution in for the sea surface temperature group of high resolution SST also came in picture. So we are basically try to identify the upwelling zones based on the GHRSST data. There is so GHRSST information we started in 2010 and 11. Now I'll come into the tuna fishery advisories. Now, as I told that these advisories presently what we are giving, it's a potential fishing zone advisory, which is for pelagic species. Now, there is a huge demand from the fishery organized sector that and actually to move the to migrate the, to shift this entire community from coastal fishing to actually deep sea fishing, so that tuna advisories came in picture. So what the general informations what we are generating with the help of PFZ, the persistence feature, so the same techniques are all only we are using. My colleague will be there, so Dr. Nimit, he will provide you the details of the tuna fishery advisories. But just one more parameter we are including here that time 2010-11, that is the actually water clarity information. So you will get a detailed this advancement of the tuna fishery advisory advisory service from my colleague Dr. Nimit will provide. Then what happened, this is the for that advanced tuna program, actually we incorporated fish tagging in experiment. So with the help of CMFRI, Central Marine Fishery Research Institute, and Fishery Survey of India, that program started for the better tuna fishery advisory services. So that will be also covered in the lecture of Dr. Nimit. And then 2012 to 2013, use of multi-satellite data. So what happens, actually sometimes we are getting from, if we are concentrating only from the particular satellite, sometimes some particular satellite misses the particular zones. So then to increase the data coverages, actually we started using 2012 to 2013, actually multi-SST. Here I have pointed out few of them, few of it, MATOP 1 SST, then MATOP 2 SST, NOAA 19, NOAA 18 SST, MODIS SST, GHR SST, all these SST informations we started exploring to increase the coverage. Then 2013 and 14 onward, tie up with the collaborators. So we 13, 14 onwards, actually we tie up with the collaborators. Collaborators means so here from that time onwards, with a lot of NGOs as well as government organizations, government agencies, and the state government, state fisheries department, we started actually collaborating with all organizations to increase the user base. So, and it will help, not only help to increase the user base, it will also provide the feedback in pan-India, means pan-India means only the maritime states. So all states, actually all maritime states, that we asked for the outreach partners and we joined with them. We validated, we given advisory, taken feedback, and the effectiveness of the advisories we explored sector-wise. Then 2014-15 onwards, then there's a huge change with the advancements of these ICT techniques. Mostly earlier we used to use only this fax, then TV, email. Then there is a huge shift happened in the with the advancements of the mobile technique. We totally shifted from SM from all this mode. We continued all this mode to SMS and Android based application system. Not only our own Apple Android system, we partner with lot of other NGOs like Swaminathan Research Foundations. We partnered with TCS and other organizations like Kisan Sanchar Limited. So various organizations is having the various apps so with which actually through which we started giving the advisories. And 2014-15 major change one thing happened, that our advisories was recognized by ISO certified, became ISO certified advisory services. Then 2015-16 onwards, actually incorporation of sea surface height in our tuna advisory, 3D tuna fishery advisories through three-dimensional. Earlier, only with the help of satellite technique, we used to give actually sea surface temperature through the surface informations. Later, with the modeling technique, actually how much depth informations we added. So that will be also covered with the lecture of my colleague. So this is the typical advisory, how it looks. I also given you the details in my earlier. So here just I'll just jot down all the things, and here in the PFZ map you are getting a most probable fishing ground. Those were the bold lines. Here the bathymetry information to the contour. So, and the Indian coastline, it's in the pink line. And the restricted zone informations. Restricted zone informations, however, it is not displayed in the Andhra Pradesh sector, but there are a lot of restricted zones are there in the Odisha for the olive Ridley breeding ground, as well as this government, some restricted zones are there. So we have incorporated in our advisory map, actually, those restricted zones information. Surface currents, inquiries is regularly doing the feedback collections from the fishermen, not only from the feedback collection of with the NGOs directly, also inquiry scientists are participating with these different awareness program in different harbors. And we came to know that if this CSR, instead of wind, if we provide the informations of sea surface current, so basically it will be a good help for the fishermen. So that's why actually we incorporated sea surface current here in the arrow. It, you can see this is the arrow direction. It is showing which direction actually sea surface current is moving, and it is actually 0.01. It means that a meter per second, actually, the speed. So this is the total how the our tuna advisory looks. You will get a good detailed presentation here. The red boundary, what you can see, it is basically the restricted zones, actually. These restricted zones are in Odisha, and these pixels are basically the depth information, so which was integrated during this 20 integrated in the advisory services. So advisories are here. You can see all. Sorry, actually there was a problem, technical problem in live. So I'll resume again, and sorry for this, as we are in the faster session, so maybe some technical problems are there. I think from the next class actually there will not that much any problem, so all will be sorted out. So as I was mentioning you, this is the ICT technique to reach the end users. So here you can see in the top left panel. So here basically in which mode actually we are giving the advisories. We are giving through telephone, we are giving through radio, then electronic display boards, fax, mobile SMS, then VKCs and VRCs, village knowledge centers and village resource centers. So we are providing through IVRS. Some of our partner institutes are IVR techniques. So in local language, fishermen can contact them, and from that helpline, actually, they can give they can get the advisories. Then inquiries actually directly providing this informations through the satellite connectivity. Through the Gagan and Navik, there is addition. So in newly we have added it. So it is in the testing phase. So sometimes what happens if there is a mobile coverages are not there, beyond the coastal areas. Sometimes it is maybe the 50 kilometer from the coast, maybe the 100 kilometer from the coast, there will be no connectivity. So with the help of satellite technique, how fishermen can get through the Navic and Gagan, actually it is in testing phase we are providing. Many of the news channels or many of the media partners are there. So through the news, actually, we are providing these advisories as well as the apps. Apps are very much important. So the economic benefit. So we have calculated with the this is also through some third party, actually. So OSF is having a huge economic benefit by ₹4161.9 crore during 2013 and 15, as well as no go ahead missions, actually. Spill of 15 to 21 tons of cost to be ₹8943 crore only during 2015. So value additions for ONGC, and then the overall economic benefits are there. So ₹3.7 trillion, and value addition for ONGC is 3.74 trillion at 12% social discount rate. So PFZ through NCAER survey, actually, there is a independent survey done during 10th and 11th plan period. So annual economic benefit will be ₹34,000 to ₹50,000 if all fishermen are using PFZ. So, and there will be a huge impact on the GDP if all along the coast fishermen are using PFZ. That is an increase of 3.9% up to 7.8% per annum if fishermen are using PFZ and OSF both service together. So environmental benefit of the PFZ National Agriculture Innovation Program. So it was 32 fishing boats in Raigad district of the Maharashtra could save the diesel up to 70,000 liters of diesels in a month. CO2 cutting by 150,000 per kg. Validation experiment, actually we are doing regularly validations experience. It is giving the saving diesels varied from 21.47 liter to 1293.53 liter. It is having a huge impact on CO2 impact through saving of fossil fuel. So 3.45 ton to 0.06 ton every year. And the National Council of Applied Research, I have already mentioned that is the having two, if all are using, it is having a huge impact on diesel consumption reduction and also in the GDP. So Central Marine Fisheries Research Institutes, they are also at done some survey. So at 15% adoption level of the fishermen can save up to 9 lakh of liters of diesel, and which translate the savings of 462 lakhs of rupees. So, and lesser greenhouse gas actually emission. And here you can see this is the outcome of the validations. So non-PFZ and PFZ, actually the experiment number amount of diesel consumption. So PFZ, those who are using, there is a significant level of this fuel consumption. Now these are the slides from all over the coast. Actually we have actually togetherly I kept in this slide. This is the fisherman feedback. We are extremely dependent. So this is Milind from fisherman from Maharashtra. He's telling that we are extremely dependent on PFZ for our livelihood. The information passed by INCOIS was very accurate and useful. This is Lisil, one fisherman from Kerala. And this is another fisherman from Kakinada, motivated to buy and use gill nets to make use of the PFZ advisory to its full potential. Fishing in PFZ is more economical the number of days we spend in the sea has come down considerably, and there is a reductions in the diesel consumption expenses. D. Tata Rao, fisherman, one from AP. MSSRF and INCOIS fishermen's are helpline service is a greater boon to us. So this is we are partnered with INCOIS is partnered with MSSRF, MS Swaminathan Research Foundation. So with for long time, and they are basically continuing the helpline services in Tamil Nadu, and these helplines are actually helplines are very much useful. I am able to educate my sons. It is mainly because of fishing through gill netting in PFZ. So another fisherman from Andhra Pradesh. It was remarkable informations, making our day of fishing much more portable with progressive fishing. So this is another fisherman from Andhra Pradesh. One more fisherman from Odisha is telling that I was happy that we could get more catch in less time. Then another fisherman from Odisha, had I not got the informations, I would have incurred a loss of nearly 2.5 lakhs and our lives also would have been at risk. I'm sure with the advisories, the fisheries, fishers will definitely be able to improve their lives and livelihood. There is another fisherman, Satish, from Andhra Pradesh. From Kanchipuram, Maran fisherman is telling that I am happy to say that without wasting energy, time and diesel, we sold the catch. I and other fishers defined PFZ informations very useful, getting quality of increased catch. I am planning to increase the storage capacity in my boat. Another fisherman from Chennai. So I must say that there is a difference in the quantity and quality of fish catch by using PFZ points. Another fisherman from Chennai. So last but not the least, this is the PFZ information has given a new lease of life to the fishermen community. This is the feedback we received from Professor Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, who encouraged us from the long time that to validate our advisories and to disseminate it in the different states in all along the coast in India, actually. So this is the feedback. So like that, this is there are several feedbacks we receive, but I would like to point out that these advisories are very much useful for fishermen, those who are doing gill netting and the pelagic fishery. So for the pelagic fishery, these advisories are very good, and earlier it was thrice a week. Presently we have converted it is daily advisories, because so the effectiveness of the advisories is very good during the first day, because there is it's a real-time images from real-time images. Afternoon actually we are getting this imagery in our ground station. From there actually we analyze, and by evening actually we are passing this informations and broadcasting to our users. Presently, INCOIS is having nearly about 7 lakh users all along the coast, and we have a target to reach all fishermen along the coast with our livelihood and sea safety informations. I hope this presentations will help you to understand what Indian Marine Service is all about, and how the remote sensing techniques can be used for fisheries management, and how INCOIS is providing these regular advisories to the fishermen in a sustainable approach. These advisories are very much useful during the first day of generations and the first day. That's why the advisories are presently daily. So all the informations are based on remote sensing and other parameters like oxygen and other gradually from the our oxygen, then mixed layer depth. All these informations are coming from our modeling approach, and one by one as per requirement we are adding in the advisory services. Regular advisory are validated to get the feedback, to understand the accuracy and to improve our quality of real-time advisory services. I know there will be several questions, several I understand that many of you already given raised your questions in your in the chat box. So I'll go through the questions, and by today, as soon as possible, actually, I'll try to answer all your questions one by one. So please bear with us. Sorry for the interruption, as it was a first day class. So maybe in between you have faced some technical problem, but our team is working on that and already resolved everything. And hope in the next class onwards, you will get without any problem. Actually, this will be go smoothly. Thank you. Well, I'll again join you for in the again another class on Wednesday. So afternoon class will be taken by my colleague. Thank you all, and keep your queries posting in the live session. Thank you.